Okay. So let's, yeah, let's start. So good morning, everybody. So obviously, I'm Nicolas Rougier. This is me. And I will try to teach you about a bit about matplotlib. So of course, first, and this is quite kind of mandatory, you need to have matplotlib installed. And does everybody have matplotlib installed? Yeah? And so in the requirement, there was something about base map. So from time to time, it's difficult to install. So in the tutorial, it will be only maybe 15 minutes for base map. And you will see there is a nice animation. So if you don't manage to install base map, it's not, not really a problem. I will show you what should be the result, but you can still type it and try later to have it installed. So the material for the tutorial is at this address, and you have we'll go to this. So this is github.com Rougier matplotlib tutorial, and you should land on this page. Everybody connected. And so, well, you can read the tutorial directly on GitHub, or you can also read it from here. Maybe the display is a bit better. It depends on your taste. It works for everybody. And so you have here, you have the installation script. So it's very basic. It checks for matplotlib, NumPy. Everybody's familiar with NumPy also? Okay, cool. And you need base map and URL lib. It's a small library to just retrieve some data from the web. And this is the official address for the tutorial. Well, you have also some other tutorial if you're interested. So there's a, I also wrote a NumPy tutorial, some NumPy exercise, and there is a 10 simple rules for better figures. So if we have time, we'll go back to this at the end of the tutorial. And so we can start. Yeah?
Can you tell us the GitHub again, please?
Sure. And I guess it's also available from the SciPy conference website. So if you're not sure about the address, you can also type matplotlib tutorial on Google, and you should find it quite easily, hopefully. Yeah?
Was base map downloaded with the stuff that you guys downloaded as part of the preparation, or do you have to do that additionally?
Sorry?
You say we need base
map. Yeah. Yeah, you have to install base map. So you get you have to get the file. It depends on your installation. So if you're on Conda, for example, you can type Conda install base map. Hopefully it will work. But in some cases, and especially it depends if you're on Windows or Linux or OS, it might be painful to install. So don't lose too much time with installing base map. And we'll see maybe on the second part of the tutorial we will need base map, but you will see we'll have fun without base map. Is it okay for the address for everybody? So you're also familiar with IPython, all of you. So well, for this tutorial you can either use regular Python. This is a perfectly okay, or you can use IPython and the notebook, so you can type your code and see the result interactively. So this is up to you. So if you're familiar with IPython, you can use it, and there is a specific mode for matplotlib. So your figure, as soon as you type some command, it will be displayed, or if you don't have the interactive mode, you have to show the figure explicitly. So this is what we will do during the tutorial. So let's pretend we're using Python. And for the first part, we will do a very simple plot. We want to show the sine and cosine function. Easy enough. So first thing is to have some data that represent the sine and cosine. So when you are using matplotlib, you are really drawing data, so you need to generate the data. You cannot say, oh, I want to plot the sine function. You have to really specify what you want to draw. So the first step is to build those data, and we can do this very easily using NumPy. So first you can import NumPy as np, so you're also familiar with this syntax. So just because we are lazy, we don't want to type NumPy at every line, so we use np for alias, and then we can type np.anything. So the first thing is to generate this line. So this is, we generate 256 data from minus pi to plus pi, and using linear space. You are familiar with this command? So mostly it's if you print, okay, we can test it. X. Okay. I just say we have to import NumPy, so I will do that. And you should obtain this X array with all the linear space value. Okay, and then, well, we can compute the sine and cosine. So NumPy provides a cosine and sine function, so it's quite easy to say C equal and we can do the same for the sine. Easy, does it work for everybody? So just to check that you have at least NumPy installed and it's working properly. So now we have X. So this will be the value on the X axis. We have C for cosine and S for sine. So next step is, okay, we want to plot them. And this is quite easy. This is written here. So this is the script. So we already type some part of it. So we import NumPy as np. We have the x, c, and s. And now, of course, we are using matplotlib. So we will import matplotlib. And more specifically, we will import one package of matplotlib, which is a pyplot. And again, we will use an alias. It will be plt. Of course, you can use any alias you want. But for this tutorial, we will use a plt. So every plt.command will be related to a matplotlib. And what we can do is, well, we can now plot X versus C, X versus S. So let's try to do that again. And now I can plot X versus C and S. And we have nothing on screen. So, does anybody have something else on screen? Do you get the figure? So, it really depends how you start. So, if you start with regular Python, if once you type this, you will have nothing on screen. If you are in interactive mode, so let's say you started IPython with some specific option, then you will see the graphic immediately. In this case, we have to explicitly ask matplotlib to show the graphic. Okay, so you have to type PLT show. And you should have this. Oh. Oh, you have IPython and nothing show up. So you have to use its dash dash PyLab option when you start IPython, and then it will say, okay, I'm in interactive mode. So if you when you start IPython, okay, let's. You know what? I will try. We'll see if it works. So I will quit Python. But if we are not in the notebook?
In the notebook, what they don't like with the dash dash PyLab, they're going to keep it around for a while longer, but they really want people to stop using it because the notebook doesn't carry that information. And so someone starting up IPython notebook or Jupyter notebook won't know that dash dash PyLab was used in, let's say, someone else's invocation of it. And so there's a disconnect there.
Yeah.
Do not recommend dash dash PyLab anymore. What they recommend is the IPython magic percent matplotlib inline in the top cell. And that will then make it interactive mode inline.
Like this. Okay.
I guess
you
can do
MBA. So the story is, so dash dash PyLab used to work, so it's not recommended anymore as you hear. So maybe you can either use a notebook, so you can start IPython with a notebook option, and then inside the notebook you can type this command, matplotlib, matplotlib inline. Well, in my case, it doesn't work, but it should work for you. Or you can use a regular Python, and then we will show every time we need to show the graphic. Does it make sense? You're supposed to be able to do it. In my case, it doesn't work for some reason. Okay, I will check at the break. So for the time being, maybe we can all use regular Python. So let's go back to Python. And so we import NumPy, we import matplotlib.pyplot as a PLT, and we regenerate, where is it, X, C, we plot sine, we plot cosine, and we show. And so, yeah, we'll fix the IPython stuff at a break, hopefully. Not even sure. So at least, does everybody got this display some way or the other? So if you are in a Python, you will notice that you cannot type command anymore. So if you want to go on with your Python shell, you have to close a figure. So just do that, and then you can type command again. OK? No, and it doesn't work twice. So everybody managed to get the figure. Of course, what you can do is also save those commands into a file and just Just execute the file, and you should obtain the figure as well. Yeah, so sorry, we have some difficulty. We'll try to fix this for the break. So it's okay for everybody. Now we got you all got this picture. Yeah. So what do you think of the picture, by the way? It's okay. Yeah, no, it's not okay. So why it's not okay? If you look at what we have typed, we say plot x comma c plot x comma s, and then matplotlib say, oh, okay, I will show this. So the question is, how does matplotlib know how to display your sine and cosine? So what you have to realize is that there is a set of defaults in matplotlib, and matplotlib will have to choose the color of your lines, the thickness of the line, the whether he has to put a box around, whether he has to put ticks, what is the font to use to display the labels, what labels, where, and everything. So this is a default of what the default are used for. So it's written here. And because you are default, you don't have to specify all the time. So if you just do nothing, you will get this picture. But those defaults have been written for any kind of graphics. So you could have the sine and cosine, of course, but it could be, I don't know, data from seismology or cosmology, and it will use the same defaults. So they are pretty much good for any kind of graph, but they are not really based for a specific graph. So this means, in this case, we can try to make the graph look better. So first things to do is to instantiate the default. So now we will just do the exact same figure, but we will specify everything. And you will see that there is a lot of things to specify. So this is a whole script. Okay, so it's much longer, of course, and we just get the same results. And if you look, the first things to do is to open a new window. So this is a figure command. So you just say matplotlib, oh, I want to draw a figure, so please create a new window. And because you are creating a new window, you also need to specify what is the size of the window. So this is what we say, figure size, and we say this is 8 by 6 in inches. Okay, so it's the overall aspect of your figure. And then you have DPI, so this is a dot per inch, and the default is 80. For each of these, you can try to, you can copy the script and try to modify any settings. Once you have created the figure, we'll create a subplot. This is also implicit when you just draw the first plot. But in this case, we have to specify the subplot. And if you ask me what is a 111 means, we'll see that later. But this is also what is made implicitly. Then we can, okay, create x, cosine, sine, and we can plot the cosine. And then we will say, oh, I want the color of the line to be blue. I want the line width, so the line thickness, to be 1 pixel. And I want the line style to be a continuous line. So those are the default. And because they are the default, you can change pretty much anything. So if you're not happy with the color, you can type any color. So color can be a name color, like blue, black, yellow, red. It can be web color, so this can be, I don't know, all the web color, antique white, or whatever you want. Or it can be also the hexadecimal code for a color. For line width, it can be 0. Can it be 0? Maybe it will complain if you say 0, but of course, if you say line thickness to be 0, you won't see the line. And the line style can be continuous, so it's only minus. It can be with a dot. It can be anything. Again, we'll see that later. For the second function, for the sign, we just change the color to green, and that's the only difference. Then we have the limits. So here we say, because we have this data that goes from minus pi to plus pi, but if you look at the figure, it goes from minus 4 to plus 4, because matplotlib computes automatically what is the best range to display your data. Of course, you can, if you want, you can use minus 1 million to plus 1 million. And in this case, what you could expect is to have only something in the middle, where all your data are the scramble, and the rest is totally empty. Okay? And then we can specify where we put ticks. So the ticks are the small small bar on the x-axis, vertical bars, that where you will put your labels. So in this case, we say, oh, we want to have ticks at minus 4, minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? And we do the same for y, the y limit. So we say we go from minus 1 to plus 1. Again, this is computed automatically. And we do the same for the ticks. So of course, we can have as much ticks, as many ticks as we want. Yeah? The text larger, I can try, maybe, better. Yeah. If you go on the web page, you will get the, it's on the web page. Okay. One important command is, of course, when you want to save your figure. And the easiest way, I like plt.savefig, so you can save the figure. So you have to give a name for the figure. And optionally, you can give the DPI. So it will enlarge or reduce your figure size. And the extension of the figure is quite important, because in this case, this is a PNG. So this is a bitmap format. And if you can also use, for example, PDF, which is a vector format. You all know the difference between bitmap and vector format? No? So bitmap means that you will really draw your picture pixel by pixel. So if you choose a size of 100 pixels by 100 pixels, so it's fine if you print it on a small surface, but if you try to enlarge the figure, it will be not good. If you are in vector format, you can zoom at any level. It will be just perfect. So it's always better to prefer PDF format if you can. Well, there are some cases when it's not so great to have a PDF format, but we can talk about that later. And last command, we say, oh, we PLT show, so we show the figure. So if you type this entire script, you should just obtain the same figure as before. And again, if you're lazy, you can type on the figure here and you will obtain the script. I will just reduce a bit. So if you click, you should get the source. Any question on this? So usually for every drawing package, it can be MATLAB, Matplotlib, Excel, or whatever, they have a set of defaults, and usually nobody tweaks the defaults. So when you see a figure, you can guess it has been made using Excel or MATLAB or Matplotlib or Bokeh, or so it's very specific for each software. So now we can try to tweak the figure a little bit, and we want to change the line width for the sine and cosine. So the idea is that you have those lines for the frame, And because the most important thing here are the sine and cosine, we want to have them thicker. So as you can imagine, what you have to do is to change the line width of the two plot commands. And you can experiment with different line thickness. And of course, if you use something like 100 for line thickness, it will be just ugly. So we just a bit of thickness, but not too much. So does it work if you change? Okay. So this is also a general advice. If you can have your line plot thicker than the frame, it will be best to show where is your data. So now it's for me, it's more clear that okay, we're interested in the data. So are we happy with this figure now? If you say yes, the tutorial is over. So, so what is the problem? Yeah, this is one problem. But for me, maybe not the most urgent, but you know, we have increased the thickness. And now if you look at, for example, the red signal, you can see that it's a kind of cut by the frame. So just before we say, oh, the y limit is -1, +1, but now we don't see the whole signal. So maybe, okay, we know this is a sine and cosine, so we have no surprise, but who knows, maybe you have one data point that just goes to minus infinite and goes back to -1 value, and you don't see it just because your y limits hide part of the signal. Well, in this case, it's not really the case. But so let's try to tweak a little the limit so we can just expand the frame. So one way to do that is to tweak the X limit and the Y limit. So again, this is in the default script. This was a command. So before it was, we can use X.min. So X is a numpy array, so we can take the minimum value. We can take the maximum value. Okay. And we just expand a little bit. And we can do the same for the y limit. Okay? Make sense? Everybody see why this computation is totally wrong in this case? No? So in this case, it will work because x minus is negative. So when you multiply by 1.1, okay, it will go back. So you really want to adapt this formula to your own data. So it's only it only works in this case. It was a quick and dirty way to set the limit. But what you should obtain now is this figure. So now we have a small white border around the data. And we are sure that we have no surprise. The cosine doesn't go to minus infinite. We are kind of sure now. Everybody. Ben? Oh, you want that?
Okay.
Oh, you have this? But yeah, this is the idea.
Okay.
So she was asking why she. What did she got minus pi and plus pi on the x axis? And of course, this is what we want to achieve. So now we have those value minus. So on the ticks, we have minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, blah, blah, blah. And well, we know we are dealing with sine and cosine. So minus 3, minus 2 are not really relevant in this case. And we would prefer to have minus pi, pi over 2, 0, and well, minus pi over 2, and blah, blah, blah. So we can also tweak the ticks for the x axis. And now we will give a list of all the ticks we want. Yeah? So in this case, we have minus pi, pi over 2, 0, pi over 2, and pi. And for the y ticks, let's say we want only minus 1, 0, and plus 1. Make sense? So you should now obtain this. Do you? Yeah? Are you happy with it? But they are labeled, it's written 3.142. Everybody knows this is pi, no? Yeah. So yeah, you're right, we need some labels. So of course, we just say, oh, you have to put some ticks at this position. And well, matplotlib is not supposed to say, oh, okay, you meant pi, so I will display pi. No, it will display the numerical value. So this is why when you specify the ticks position, you can also specify the label to be printed at this position. And of course, what we want to do is to say, oh, I want to print pi instead of 3.142. And this is how we do it. So it's not that obvious. Okay, so this is how you write the label pi. Anybody know why we are writing this? Yeah, in fact, this is LaTeX. Everybody's familiar with LaTeX?
I've heard both.
Yeah. So let's pretend this is the idea is that you need to be able to write any kind of labels. So, of course, we can use Unicode. Everybody's familiar with Unicode. So, for example, if we go back, so here, well, I always use this. You have all those symbol available as a regular character, and if you look, maybe you will find pi somewhere or not. Yeah. Okay, I cannot find it. So anyway, you could try to write pi using those character, which are regular character. Problem is that you can also maybe want to write any kind of labels, and then you need some engine to be able to display just anything in mathematical writing. So the solution is to use LaTeX notation, and this is why we use a dollar sign, just to say matplotlib, okay, what is what follow is LaTeX formula, and you have to interpret this formula. And the way to write pi in LaTeX is backslash pi, okay? And then you have the R here. This is to tell the string you have to not escape the character inside. So the backslash here is a real backslash. If you forgot to add the R, well, you will get some problem. Make sense?
Yeah. Next line.
So here we have pi over 2. So we can also use some LaTeX. If you want to have a nice fraction, you can use frac. So I will write it here. So you can use frac of pi 2. So this is a LaTeX way to say nice fraction. So you'll have pi over, really over 2. But in our case, we just go the easy way and we say slash 2, and it will be enough. Okay? Does it work for everybody? Yeah? Yes, no, maybe? Yeah. Thank you. okay, so we can do the same for the Y ticks. But why do we want to do that? Because we have to write 1, 0, and minus 1. So what's the use of LaTeX for doing this? Yeah. But it's not only the size, it's also the font that will be used. So when you want to display mathematics, you need to have a nice font that include all the different characters, glyphs, that are needed to display mathematics. And so there are only a few fonts that are able to do this, so it's not that common because you have a lot of different mathematical signs. So if you look here, the font, I don't remember the name, but it's very specific. So just for being using the same font, we will also specify the Y ticks using the LaTeX notation. And you should obtain this. So now we are a bit more happy because now we have relevant label on the X axis. So now we can starting to guess, okay, this is a sine and cosine because I saw the minus pi 0 plus pi.
And this feature is good anywhere that text is accepted. So not just the text labels or anything like that. Title, any of that.
Yeah. So now what we want to... Well, it's only for matplotlib, and it's not the full LaTeX engine. In a regular Python, you don't have any access, I think. And the implementation, I don't even know what is. You will get the explanation.
So what it is there's two modes. So native in matplotlib is the math text thing, which is a subset of the LaTeX language. So we parse that natively. It looks a lot like LaTeX. It covers a lot of the use cases that people need. But if you need a full-fledged LaTeX support, there's actually two other ways you could do this. I'm not gonna go into one of them, but the other one, you do the same exact stuff. You do the dollar signs and all that jazz, but then usually anywhere where you accept text parameters or you can have a keyword argument, use text equals true, or you can set an RC parameter. I'm assuming you'll cover RC parameters stuff later, I guess, which you could set use text equals true. If you already have LaTeX installed, it will actually, matplotlib will actually go and have LaTeX render the text for it and then bring that back into matplotlib under the hood for you. You don't have to do anything. But if you have LaTeX installed and all that stuff, it will actually be done by LaTeX. But the default native thing that's built right into matplotlib doesn't require LaTeX at all. But you get a subset of the language.
Any other question? Okay, so now we want to get rid of the frame around the figure. You may wonder what are those from the beginning. Again, this is one of the default, and this is a choice of matplotlib to. Okay. Yeah, so we want to move those lines. So, well, actually, they are called spines. And as you can guess, there are four of them. So left, right, top, and bottom. And you can move them any way you like. And you can also just remove them if you want. So in our case, what we want to achieve is to have only a cross in the middle. Because, well, this is how I remember when I learned sine and cosine. We have this graphic, so I just want to have the same. And so we'll just try to do that. So one of the first command we want to do is to get what is called the axis. We'll go back to that later. And we assume this is an inheritance of MATLAB, so we can ask, what is the current axis? Okay, so this is the first line here. I will make it bigger. So here you have plt.gca. So this is, okay, give me the current axis. And from this object, then I can manipulate the spines. And luckily, there is a method called, well, it's an attribute called spines. And you have the right, the top, bottom, and left. So first, we have only two, we will say, oh, set the color to none. So it means transparent, so it just disappear. So we get rid of the right spine and the top spine. So it means at this point, we have only half the frame we had before. Okay. Then we have to say, oh, where are the ticks position? And then we'll say, oh, we'll put them on the bottom, just because we get rid of the top spine. And we'll say, so we'll go back to that later. Now we will say, what is the position of the spine, and we'll say, oh, the position will be, so the spine, this is the bottom spine, so you can only move it vertically, and we say the position is zero, and there is this word data. So we say we mean the position is zero in reference to the data, because it could be zero in a reference to the window, for example, or to some other reference. So we'll go back to that later, but in matplotlib you have a different reference to give the coordinate of a specific point. We'll see that just after. So for example, you have the data reference. So you say in the sine and cosine, let me show you. So here, this is zero and zero in the data reference frame. But for the window, for example, if my window is, 500 pixel and 500 pixel, this specific point is 250 and 250. And if I consider my window to be normalized, like 01, 01, then this point is 0.5, 0.5. Make sense? So it means for a specific point on screen, you have many ways to give the coordinate. But when you will change the size of the window, the coordinate won't change the same way. So if you are in, let's say, an absolute coordinate with a 200 pixel, you will always be 200 pixel from the bottom of the window. If you are in a normalized coordinate, your point will move with the window. If you are in a data reference, it will move with the data. So when you change the x limit or the y limit, your point will move with those limits. Okay? So this is why we say the position is zero relative to the data coordinate. So if I change the limit, this will be always on the zero. Okay? Yeah?
So just to clarify, did you say the offset position was zero, or do you do the same thing?
The top. Oh yeah, I can do the same for the right and for the top. Is that your question?
Yeah, like basically, can you swap out bottom, left, or top, and
right? Well, between top and bottom, you have in this case you have to choose one of them.
Right.
So you can either use the top or the bottom. You can even use both, but it will be a waste of ink because it will be in the. On the same line. So in the end, we do the same for the spine, and we set the position to zero. So for example, what you can do is try to set this position for the left, not on zero, but on a minus pi over 2. And you should obtain this line at this position. OK? So for example, you can have put the right on the minus pi over 2 and put the left on the pi over 2. Okay, is it clear for everybody? So try to, again, you can click the figure, you will get the whole script, and try to modify some of the parameters, and especially the zero. So, there was a comment some minutes ago that, okay, we still don't know what is the sine and what is the cosine. Well, if you know the function, you can guess. But obviously, you will do that with your own data. And so people want to know, okay, what is the blue line, what is the red line? So of course, we want to add a legend to say what is what. So this can be done quite easily using a label when you plot your data. So in this case, for the cosine, we just add a keyword called label, and we say, oh, okay, this is a cosine, the label is cosine. We can do the same for the sine, and very intuitively, we have the legend command, and so we say, Loc is for location, so you have to choose where you want to put your legend, and you want to put this legend on a part of the graphic when there is where there is no data. So in this case, this is upper left, and frame on equal false means, oh, I don't want to have a frame around my legend. So it's personal test. If you want to have a frame, you can. But it's not mandatory. And now you should obtain something like this. Does it work for everybody?
Just a bit of a heads up, the next upcoming version of matplotlib, that frame on is a bit of a misnomer. What the frame means, I draw the box, and what we did, what we changed in 2.0 is that the box by default doesn't have an outline.
Okay.
So some people are getting confused and say frame on is true, they're expecting that outline, but what they mean is, does the box appear below it?
Yeah.
So that's a little misleading. We're going to try to tweak that before we do the 2.0 release, but just to, we'll try to make that a little bit more clear coming. But before 2.0, that does mean what that means.
Yeah, by the way, I didn't specify that I'm using matplotlib 1.5, so the next version is coming quite soon.
1.5 went out like last week, and then 2.0 is coming, we promise.
So we'll stick with the old version. So something might change in the future. In any case, I forgot to mention, because my screen is too small, in the tutorial on the web page, well, it's also on GitHub, it's not that obvious, you have all the pointer to the documentation for matplotlib. So for any command we have been using until now, you have a dedicated documentation. And you have, for example, I was talking about all the transformation and the reference. You have a dedicated transformation tutorial that you can read on the website, and it's really well written. You will get a sense of it. For example, here you have all the command for all the documentation for all the command we have been using. As matplotlib is well documented, so you can have access to a lot of documentation from the website or even in the console when you have a question about a specific argument. And this is true for just anything. Now we have the tricky part. Well, not that tricky. We want to annotate some point. And we want to do that. And it's not that easy because we have to deal with many many transformation. So, first we want to choose some specific point on the graph. So in our case, we choose T, this value of T, 2 pi over 3. And where is it? We want first to draw point. So the question is, how can you draw point using matplotlib? So what I did in this example, I use a powerful command, which is a scatterplot, that allows you to display a lot of points. And because it can display a lot of points, it can also display a single point. So we just use this. This is the most straightforward to do that. And so we give this time the x again, and x, t, and cos of t. This is the size of the point. We'll go back to that later. And the color is blue. So when you do that here, is it readable for everybody? So the command is scatter. You will obtain this point. OK? And of course, you can do the same for the sign. And you will get the red point. And we can also plot a new line. So this time, this is not the sine or the cosine. This is really, we plot a straight line from the point to the x-axis. Again, we just give all the data. So this is tt for the x, so it will be a vertical line. And it goes from the cos of t to 0. So color is blue. This is this part. Is that clear for everybody? And here the line is minus minus. So it means dash line. Okay? And then we have this long command, and this is because we want to annotate the point. So annotate means we want to have an arrow that point to our the data we want to show. So it goes from origin to destination, and then we have to put the text. And for all of this, you have to specify everything. So of course, you have to specify the text of your annotation. So in this case, this is a text. And I think there's a question.
I ran this, I got your plot. It looks good, but I also got some kind of error message.
What is the error message?
It's a long sequence of things.
That's really busy.
So the annotate command is, maybe one of the most difficult to understand because you have to specify a lot of things. So as I say, first, you have to give the text. So again, this is a LaTeX for the tech engine. So I will let you read, but mostly the text is something, it will render like this. Then we have to say, what do you want to annotate? So this is X, Y, and we give the couple X and Y. And we say, this is in data coordinate. So we are not in, window coordinate or normalized window coordinate. We are already in data coordinate. Then you have the X, Y of the text. So you have your point. You specify the coordinate. Then you have to specify the where you want to put the text. And when we say, the text coordinate is plus 10, plus 30, and those coordinates are offset points. So it means it's relative to the data. We will add 10 and 30 in points. And points is a unit for text, for font size, okay? Make sense? So first we tell where is the data, and relative to that we say where we will put our text. So when we will increase the window or whatever, it will follow the point. And you have the font size, so this is how big is your text. So you can make teeny or very big. 16 is a, let's say, regular size. And you have the arrow property. So I won't explain everything. You have to go to the documentation. But you can draw any kind of arrow. So you can imagine any arrow, and matplotlib can will be able to do it. Or in the worst case, you can do it yourself. But this is, so in our case, this is a curved arrow. It's not. Not that obvious, but we specify every property. So in the end, we got this. Okay. No question. Yeah, so the question is if the text will move with the data. Yeah, it will. In this case, it will move with the data, because the destination of the annotation is a point. It's specified in data point, and the text is an offset relative to this data point. So it will follow, and it will follow with a fixed size. Yeah, you have to, because when you're, so in my case, I knew that where was the text approximately, and then you want to draw it. And if, of course, if you inverse, for example, for the sign, if you inverse X and Y, your text will be here, and it will cover the data, which is not good. There is no good way to find where to put your annotation. And in some cases, it's just impossible. Or you have to put a very long arrow and to remove, to put your text somewhere. Yeah? Oh, you mean around here? Yeah. You can. So the question, can you add a white border around? Yes, usually you get a white border, and most of the time you want to get rid of this white border. Yeah, you can, of course. For example, the legend, it's inside the plot, but we can also put it outside. I will show some examples later where you just want to have things outside the main frame. So this is how our figure looks like so far. And usual question, are we happy with this figure now? Yes, no? Yeah, better. It can be even better. So what is the problem now? Yeah, so can you read this? Of course, you can guess it's minus pi, but we can really read it because the signal cover the label. So let's try to fix this. And what you can do for the label, and they have a bound, well, you can add a box for each label. It will be a box approximately the size of the label. And it will, we will use it for background, but a transparent background. So this is how you can do that. So here, which is interesting for our function, we iterate over every labels in the figure. So we, you remember we have AX, this is a PLT GCA, this is a current axis. And we ask for every X tick labels and Y tick labels. So this is labels. So first we can make it a bit bigger, setting the font size to 16. And we can say, oh, I want to have a bounding box, which will be white. This is the color of the box. The edge color, so this is a, you know, the line around the box, which we, color will be none, so it means no line around. And alpha is a transparency. So my box will be transparent, so we can see behind what's behind. So the result should be something like this. So if you look closer, you can see we can guess there is a box behind. Okay. So again, you can have all the documentation on the matplotlib site for the artist and B-box. Any question on this? It's everybody managed to get the final figure? Everybody's happy with the final figure? But if you're not happy, you can suggest modification and send me a pull request to change it. But I think it's not so bad. So now you can see really the first figure with using the default for matplotlib was okay. We could see the all the important stuff, but of course when you start tweaking your all the parameters, you can achieve a better results. And of course it costs you some time to do that, but with the practice it's easier and easier to do it, and it can really improve your data. So now we can have a look at a more global look on a matplotlib, and maybe the first concept that we have been manipulating, the most important are figure and subplots. So far we have only been using one subplot. So if you remember the first, when we instantiate all the default, we have this weird line, it's called plt.subplot111. And the idea is that when you draw, so when you create a figure, you can think of the figure as a window, okay? And inside is this window, you can put plot. Those are called subplot. And for the exercise we just did, we have of course one window, and we have been using only one plot. So it covers the whole area of the window. But in some case, you want to, you need two plot side by side or two plot up and down. And so you have to specify this. The way to do that is first to, when you to issue a plot subplot, you have to say how many lines and how many column you intend to use. So this is a visual division of your window area. And for example, in this case, I say, I will draw subplot. Considering two lines and only one column. So here, this is two lines, first line, second line. This is one column. We have only one column. And this is the first subplot. And here we have, again, two lines. So this is the same, one column. And this is the second subplot. Row. Yeah. For French, it's the same row. But you're right, it's a row. You can, of course, do the other way around. So we consider one row and two columns. And again, you say, this will be the first. This will be the second. So when you issue this command, when you say subplot 211, matplotlib will give you back an axis. And this object means all this area. And so when you issue commands, you will use this object to say, I want to draw something in this area. So let's say you can write ax1 equal to this, ax2 equal to this. And then you can say, I want to draw to this one or this other one. Okay? And of course, you can also have two rows, two columns. What is important to remember is that, I want to have, this is a first subplot, second, third, and fourth. And you cannot really change this order. So this is one of the limitations. So when you have only two graphics side by side, it's quite convenient. It's very, very easy. What if you want to have something like this? Yeah, we can do that. No, we have also some other way to do this. So this solution is the most straightforward, easy, and it corresponds to a lot of cases when you have only a few graphics. When you start to have a more complex layout of your subplots, you want to change for something more more powerful. And for example, you can use directly axes. So when you issue the subplot command, there is some machinery behind that gives you just the right axis, the one you want. You can also say, I want to give myself all the different size of my subplot. So now what we to do that, you use the axis command, and you are using normalize window coordinate. You remember? So you consider your all window. So it goes from 0 to 1, from 0 to 1. And you, for example, so here I say, the x and y position of the bottom left corner is 0, 1, 0, 1. And the size, this is the size? Yeah. And the size is .8.8. So the size of this window will be 80% of the whole window. Okay. Make sense? Yeah? So for example, this one is a coordinate for the bottom left is .2.2, so it's just above this one. And you got the size is .3.3. So when you do that, when you resize the window, you will see that the frame will expand following the size of the window. It's always a fraction of the window. Yeah?
Can you put text on the larger figure to surround the plot
Yeah, so you, for example, you can consider this first axis. That could be 0, 0, 1, 1. So it means take the whole figure. So you can draw everything. And then you can have this one that will, let's say, dot 1, dot 1, dot 8, dot 8. It's a, you are 10%, 10%, size 80%, 80%. And so you have a 10% frame around. And you, you can, if you want to just draw in the border, you can use one or the other. But also, in, once you have your axis, you can also put your the frame of your figure inside, and you will have also a border. So this is another examples, and we can try to. So if you draw it, you should have this. And when you resize, you can see. So it's all relative. Okay? So if at some point you, you really need to have a very precise axis at this, this position, you always have this solution to specify every coordinate. Of course, it's a, might be a lot of work. You, you might need a pen and paper to compute the coordinate, but in the worst case, you can use this. But there are now much better way. It's not, okay, it's not here yet. We'll, yeah. So I forgot to, so there are much better way, and so the better way is called axis grid, and this is an one example of axis grid. So it should be the other way around. So in this case, you really divide your window into, let's say, 3 by 3, but now you can also say, oh, my figure will be 3 columns and 2 rows. Or 2 rows and 2 columns, and starting at row 1 and column 1, for example. So you have much more freedom to organize your layout. So in this case, for example, this is 3 rows by 3 columns, and this one is 3 columns wide. It starts at column 0, and this is 1 row wide, and it starts at row 0. So this is here. So first you have, you can say grid spec 3 by 3. So it really means a virtual division of your window 3 by 3. And then you can explain for each axis where it starts and how big is it. So you have to look and experiment with this notation, because it's not totally obvious the first time. And again, you have the documentation here. Grid spec. Oh, click on the figure and you will get the code. So if you click here. Oh, this is bad. Does it work for everybody, this? So the first one, so if you look, this is how you specified the both the location, the position, and the size of the of your subplot. So in this case, for zero, so on the first axis, this is rows. So you say, oh, I'm only taking the row zero. And you know this notation, it means, but I'm taking all the columns. So in the end, you are on row zero, and you get all the columns. And if you look, this is this one, row zero, and I'm expanding on all the columns. This one is row one, but you are using only two columns. This one is row three and only one column. Row three and column one. Okay, so it's quite powerful. You can achieve a lot of different layout. So if you have to choose, if you need some complex layout, maybe grid spec might be the most useful. And again, if you have a very, very specific need, you want, at the last resort, you can use axis and give yourself all the coordinates. Okay? Okay, we have been using ticks. Until now, we have been giving all the ticks we wanted to have as a list. But it can be much more powerful. You have all kind of different ways to specify ticks. Most of the time, those ticks are made computed automatically by matplotlib. But again, if you really need, you have all this different way of putting ticks. Of course, you have you can have no ticks at all. You can have a linear multiple locator, so you just give, I want a tick every two units. You can just give the list of all the ticks we want. This is what we have been doing for the sine and cosine examples. You have a logarithmic locator, etc. No question of this? Okay, so. Yeah. The thickness, you can also control the orientation. So does it go inward or outward? You can, I think the style maybe. Yeah, what else can you do? I think we have some examples below. Also, now what we will do is some animation, because now we have some nice animation engine in matplotlib. So for a long time it was kind of difficult to have an animation. So in a matplotlib, so we had all kind of hacks to achieve some results that depend on the platform and all kind of things. But now we have a very nice API, so it's really easy to have animation on screen and to save them. And so we will try to do that. And this is where we will need base map at some point for a small part. So who doesn't have a base map installed? One, two, three. Yeah. Well, I will show the result online. But for the first part, we don't need base map because we are doing some rain. So I want to draw rain. How can I do that? So the idea, we want to have circles that just grow and disappear. So I will show you. We want to do that. Can you see it?
Yes.
It's rain. It's obvious. So how can we do that? So first thing is to when you have an idea for animation or you want to animate something, how can I do that? What is the object that can be behind this? So if you remember, so this is mostly a circle. And if you remember, we have seen the scatter command. So this is only a scatter plot. And I told you that we can specify the size of the marker, and this is what we are using right now. We can specify the color, the individual color for each marker, and this is what we are using. And what we do is just we draw a scatter plot and we make the marker to go bigger and bigger and bigger, and at some point they disappear. Okay, so let's just do that. Okay, so first we need to decide how many number of circles we want. So I say we can do animation with matplotlib. Well, it's decent animation. You cannot expect to do a game using matplotlib. So there are some limits. You cannot draw a million animated points. So it has some limits, but it's quite useful. So first thing is we'll create a new figure and we'll add an axis. So you remember I said we can add a use axis. Just axis that will take the full size of the window. So it goes from a coordinate for the bottom left is 0, 0, and the size is 1, 1, meaning I take the whole window. I say frame on equal to false, meaning I don't want to have any frame for the axis. And aspect is 1, because I want to keep the aspect ratio to 1, which means it should be more or less square. Yes? And then we have all the parameters. So first we decide on the number of rings. So let's say 50. We have the minimum size. So this is the size it starts when it starts to grow. And the final size. So one ring will go to size min to size max. Okay. Here this is Is it big enough? Yeah. So this is a position, the initial position of all the different circles. So this is just random uniform between 0 and 1 because we are in normalized coordinate. And we have the different colors. And so we need 50 different colors because we have 50 rings. And we have, so the size of the color is n by 4. So one color is RGB, so red, green, blue. And the fourth coordinate is for transparency. So this is the alpha channel. Okay? And we use 0, 0, 0. So this is a black color. And one is fully opaque. So at this point, all the colors are just black. And what we do here is that we say, oh, but from the first ring to the last ring, we will use an increasing alpha channel. So it will go from fully transparent to fully opaque. So when you look here, sorry, I will decrease again. When you look at this figure, all the rings are black, but they appear with different color only because of the alpha channel. And so you have currently, there should be 50 rings. I'm not sure they are all here, but sorry, because some of them are really almost transparent. Okay? Yep. Sorry, again. And then we have the ring size. So again, for the ring size, we go from the minimum size to the maximum size that we have decided. We have n size because we have n rings, and so this is just linear space from the minimum size to the maximum size. And then we can draw. So we use AX, so until now we have been using PLT dot something. So now we are using specifically, explicitly the axis we have built just before. So if you remember, this is this line. So we have the X coordinate for the rings. We have the Y coordinate. S is for the size. LW is the line width. So this is very, very thin. We have the edge color, and the edge color are the C array we just built, and we have the face color, which is none. So the edge color is really the line around, and the face color is what's inside. In our case, they are totally transparent, so there is no color. We see through it. Okay? Then we can get rid of the ticks, set the limit to 0 and 1, and you should obtain this. Do you get it, all of you? And so now the idea is we want to animate this. And so what we will do is to we want to reuse the data from the plot. So we have, at this point, we have 50 rings that go with the alpha going from 0 to 1 and the size going from a size min to size max. So there is one ring which is totally transparent and which is at maximum size. So it means it's not on screen. For the next frame, we will reinitialize this ring specifically. So we'll give it a new position. We'll reset back the size to minimum size, and we will reset the alpha channel to fully opaque. Make sense, or? So in fact, we reuse all the rings. So this is, imagine this is all the different points. This one is a big, it's the biggest size and totally transparent. So we reset it and put it here. And we advance one frame. So we decrease the alpha for every ring, and we increase the size for every ring. And so there is a new ring at the end of the buffer, which is the biggest size with a totally transparent. And again, we reset it. So in the end, we have an array with only 50 rings anytime. But at each frame animation, we take the last ring, which is biggest and transparent, and we reset it. So we save some time. So for this, we need, and this is how you make an animation, you need to tell matplotlib, okay, what do I do for next frame, animation frame? How do I change the data? So this is an update function. This is where we write anything we want, and matplotlib will execute this at every frame. It will do that using this object. So this is a func animation call. You have the figure. We are working on the fig is, if you look, it's here. Okay. You have the update function. This is where you update your data, your object, or whatever. This is an interval between two frames. Bleed equal true, I'm not sure I remember, nor if it's actually needed. We'll see that. And they say, oh, I want to have to display only 200 frames. So of course, you can have an infinite animation, but in this case, we will stop after 200 animations. I think it's a, let me check. Okay, I will check the documentation. I think it's a animation, okay. So from the animation package, let's try it. So if you import matplotlib, yeah. So the func animation is animation.func animation. So going back to this, this is where we do what I've been talking about. So we have those P is the position of the rings, C is the color, S is the size. So you can consider all these three arrays. And inside, we have an index that is increased one at a time for at each call. And at this point, we reset position, color, and size. So this is really a trick to save some time. OK? So the index is, OK, this is my running index. So E frame modulo 50, because we have a, it should be N, we have a 50 rings. So it just iterate over the buffer. And at this particular index, we reset position, we set the size to the minimum, and we set the alpha channel to 1. OK, and you should obtain this. Does it work for? Frame is not defined. So you don't have the.
Yeah, at the line where I bring.
Oh, but it should be here. Let me. I will try. Oops. I will check the. So for me, it's working. Let me check. Okay, ready for the second part? So we made some rain in Texas, so we are super strong. But of course, the goal is to use this animation. And we want to now to see earthquake on the Earth. And of course, as you can imagine, we will use this animation to display earthquake. And so the idea is that we want to know where are the last earthquakes, where they happen in the last 30 days. So I'm not into seismology at all. So I tried to find some source to get this data. So the data are freely available from the earthquake USGS.gov. And so you can choose which one you want to get. So in the last 30 days, you can even choose which are the one above. It's a 4.5, 2.5, or 1.0 for the strength of the earthquake. And I just discovered there's a lot of earthquake every day on the surface of the Earth. Any people in seismology here?
We're geologists.
Okay.
Kind of close.
So I will try not to say too. Yeah, just no. So this is why we need the base map, because we will get the place of the earthquake in terms of coordinate in longitude and latitude, and we need to translate this into window coordinate. This is why the base map package is needed in this case. So the first part is just to get the data, and this is this part. So we need the URL lib library. This is just to get the data from the website. This is the address of the field. And you can choose a significant earthquake in the last 30 days. Okay? And I choose only magnitude greater than 4.5, because there are so many with a magnitude greater than 2.5, maybe there are 1,000 in the last 30 days. So I was quite surprised to see so many earthquakes. And okay, this is, let's say, a dirty reading of the data. So it's a bit boring. And maybe also I'm ashamed of the way I did it, but it works. So we get the data. So probably is a better way to do it. So mostly you get the text file and you extract the information. So we are interested in location. So we get longitude and latitude and the magnitude. And well, obviously we need to display the Earth. So this is also done using base map. So this is, I will increase. This is this line, Earth equal base map projection equal mil. So don't ask me. Well, there are many, many projections. So this is one of the most straightforward for people not into the domain. And we can also draw coastline and field continents. So this is, again, very specific to base map. Well, base map is a kind of a big library for geology, seismology. The other one is a cartopy. I don't know how to pronounce it. So there are the two main library for dealing with geology, seismology, and stuff like this. In our case, we'll only use those three commands. So first, we draw the Earth, and second, using the projection, we translate geological coordinate into a window coordinate. And then we have exactly the same script. So we use the rain animation, but this time we will also use some colors, because for a very big earthquake, we want to have them in a red, and for the other one, we will make them in a blue. Okay? And then what we do at each frame, we will pick the next earthquake. And so instead of initializing randomly the coordinate, we will convert the coordinate into the window coordinate, and then we start the animation. And okay, no, we also choose a color to decide if it's blue or red. So red means very big, and blue means, not so big. And this is this line. So if the magnitude is below 6, the color will be blue, and else it will be red. So big earthquake will be red. Any question on this? So if you run the script, you should obtain something like this. And I will try to run it myself. And you should see. do you get the results? So they are not so, so the red has the biggest one. Also, one problem with that, so of course, with each earthquake, you get a date. So we should change the script to take the date into account. So in this animation, at each frame, we get the next earthquake. So the chronology of the earthquake is not respected in this animation. So we need to we would need to tweak the script a little bit to take this into account. But we can see the place where the a lot of earthquake. Works for everybody. So in the end, we went from a scatter plot, and we can have this kind of animation, which is quite convenient. So if you want to have a more earthquake, so let's say maybe you can. Okay, let's try to see if it works. We can choose to have more. Sorry?
I'm running into an error with the URL.
Unexpected function for what?
Oh,
maybe this is a previous version. You can try to remove the request and just type urllib.open directly. In the previous version, the request was not needed.
Yeah.
That's bad. Yeah, you can. I think you can remove the request part. So instead of urllib.request.open, it's .open. So here, I increase the number of rings from 50 to 100. So it still works, it's maybe a bit slower. And of course, the more rings you have, and the slower it will be. Any question on this? So if, yeah. Sorry, I didn't understand. Okay, I will come to see. You get that? Okay, I'll come.
Oh, yeah.
So what is...
So it's not happy about something about data.split and saying a byte length object is required, not string.
Oh.
Even though, you know, data equals split, that command...
Is that Python 2?
It's missing a B in front of that comma in the string.
Yeah.
You have to put a B before the first quote.
Yeah.
If you click on the tutorial, the code there is slightly different from...
Oh, so where do we need to be? This is the that one was executed.
Yeah.
Data.split B and
right before that first.
Oh, what is put in?
Just like that.
Yeah.
to letter B.
Before the first full bar.
Maybe, yeah, if you run directly the script.
Yeah.
If you run directly the script, so do you have the
do you have
the repository of the tutorial somewhere?
Somewhere I have that. Somewhere.
Yeah, if you look at the.
I had the same error.
Oh yeah, he got the same error. So I think, can you run? Do you have the? Can you save the script and run it? Because I think what's inside the tutorial is not exactly the script. Can you? Save the file and run it. It should be.
It's URL lib2.url open.
That URL open. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's no request. So URL. So you have to import URL lib two.
Right. Oh, there is a URL lib two.
In Python 2. It was one of those things in Python 3 that they merged all that stuff and had just URL lib.
Yeah, okay.
And that's what the 6th module was to help you out with.
Yeah. Yeah, because I changed it for Python 3 and
right.
Okay.
She has an older machine here, so.
Can you send me a email just I remember to change that?
Sure.
Yeah,
sure.
Thank you. No more question on this. So we have this example with animation. Again, if you go to the matplotlib website and also in the source, you will have a lot more animation examples, like a pendulum or you can have any kind of animation. Again, you have to see if you can do your animation using matplotlib. So don't expect to have a full-blown animation. It's based on matplotlib objects, but you see with a scatter plot we can have this kind of things. With a line plot you can have a pendulum, you can have all kind of idea. The idea is that first you have your object, you have update function, you update your graphic object, and you go on. So okay, so let's go back to the tutorial. Oh, this is a part I prefer because you will be walking. So far we have been seeing the regular plot. So this is a plot line. We have been using the scatter plot, so for the animation. And if you remember, just to put the annotation on the sine and cosine examples. And of course, you have many more objects. So, if you if you are familiar with a graphic figure, you will have all the standard objects. So, of course, you have the bar plot. So, any kind, any shape, any size, any style. You have the contour plot. So, we'll go back to this. You have the imshow command. This is to show an image. So, this is it can be your data or like a regular image. You have a quiver plot. So, when you have a 2D fields of arrows. You have pie chart, but you don't want to use pie chart. It's bad, but you can do it. You have a grid. So, grid, you can have grid for any kind of plot on top of your regular plot. You can have, multi-plot. We saw this with axes, subplot, and everything. You have a different coordinate system. For example, you can have a polar axis. So you just draw your graphic as usual. And at some point you say, oh, this is a polar axis. And automatically it will transform your graphic. So in this example, this is a bar plot using polar axis. So it just transforms this way. you have 3D plots, so it's not total 3D, it's more like 2.5D. So you can have a decent 3D, but it's not, there's a lot of problems, so it's not full-blown 3D, but it's maybe it's sufficient for most simple cases. And of course, you have a text, so it means you can draw any kind of text. Yes?
So a question about your scatter plot. So the way you did it, you represented the color by, you gave the value based on the arctangent between y and x.
For which example are you talking?
Scatter plot.
Yeah, the one we have been using for?
Well, no, the one you have right here.
Oh, here. Yeah, so this is...
So, my question is, when you specify color, you can, there's some kind of real value color number, which goes from something to something, and
Yeah, so this is part of the exercise. So we'll come to this, but in this case, we're using a color map and the angle.
Yeah.
Yeah, so for the colors, well, there are many, okay, so let's back to color. When you assign a color to an object, you can assign, of course, a real color, like a red, blue, or anything. And in some cases, you can assign a value. This value will relate to a color map. And this color map is responsible for mapping your value to a color. This is how things are done in some cases. This is a case for scatter plot, if you want. But for example, for ImShow, when you show an image, you will give, let's say you have a one-channel image. So this is a gray image. You can use this value. So gray image means each point has one value. The gray level from, let's say, 0 to 1. And you have a color map that say, oh, if your value from 0 to 1, you have to use this color. So you map this to some... we'll have an example with a color map. We'll see that. In this example, this is what is used. So we have a color map, and we assign value to the scatter, and then it will be drawn like this. Yeah, there's some, unfortunately, yeah, there's a default color map. It's a jet color map.
Not anymore, in 2.0.
Yeah, we're in 1.5, so the default is a jet color map. It's ugly, it's you cannot use it. So there is a default color map, yeah. So now there is a good color map in the most recent version of matplotlib. Before that, it's called the jet color map. And it's you don't want to use a jet color map for all kind of reason.
So the color map can be used in any of these plot routines we've done, but you don't have to specify an alpha numeric color. You can just use the color map.
Yeah, we'll see some examples in
for certain kinds of plots. Yeah, so like plot, yeah, but scatter, IMShow, p color, so other kinds. Yes, it can take color.
But I mean, there's a default color map that's built into the plot routine.
Yeah, so there's a whole default system in matplotlib that controls not just color map, but all bunch of other stuff. And if you don't specify it, it will fall back to the defaults. But you can, in the command, specify another color map if you want. We have a whole library of color maps available.
Right. No, I'm not trying to get that fancy. I guess what I'm trying to get at is, in cases where we've been using green or blue or red,
No. In wherever it says color or C, face color, edge color, those are just a single value, single color value. But in places where which you might want to be specifying many, many, many colors, that's where you're using color maps. So IMShow, scatter, P color, things that, they're called scalar mappables. And so basically you map a scalar value to a color and it will do all that under the hood for you.
But the syntax is the same, right? Because it says, I'm looking at it, it's code, and it says C is equal to real value.
Yeah. We'll make the exercise and we'll see the example.
That is only true with scatter, and that's because that's a MATLABism. But none of the other functions do that.
Okay.
Yes. That is only a MATLABism that carried over because matplotlib was inspired by MATLAB.
Okay. Thank you.
But you'll try to manipulate this. Okay, so we have been dealing with sine, cosine, so this is what I call regular plots. And so we'll play with this again, and the idea is that you start from this script here. Okay, so if you look into the tutorial, this is a starting script, and I want to have this. Well, of course, if you click on the picture, you will get the solution. The idea is that you are trying to... you don't see it. The idea is you try to make the exercise. You have an int, is that you can have a look at the... So in this case, you need to use a fill between command. And as you can imagine, fill between means you fill between one value and the other. Okay? And so, of course, the idea is that you make errors and you learn much from your error. So if you look at the documentation for the fill between, you can see that what you have to give as argument, this is x, y1, and y2, that will default to 0. And you can already try with this. So in the first case, for the upper part of the figure, you can use directly the fill between. So you have the x, you have the in the documentation the y1, which is in this case y plus 1, and the second one is 0. So the y is 0, and so you will fill between 0 and your curve. So at the first, here this is a y2, and this is y1 from the documentation. Okay, and you have your x. And so you just fill between the curve and the y2, which is 0. Okay? Second one is a bit different because now we have alternating color between blue and red. And again, if you look at the documentation, you will see there is another argument, which is where. So you can say to the command, oh, you have to fill between this curve and this curve if some condition. Without looking at the answer. So in our case, the condition is, okay, we'll fill between y and 0 if y is greater than 0, for example. So it means it will only fill the upper part because this line here is 0. And we can do the same for the red. Let's say fill between y and 0 if y is negative this time. Okay, so the command is pretty versatile and you can do any kind of filling. So it may be useful in some case. So again, if you want to have the solution, just click on the figure. Any question on this? So we can go to the scatterplot example. And again, you start from this script. And you want to achieve the result as in the figure. And so the hint is that the color is given by the angle of X and Y. Oh, you have a question, yeah? On the solution, you mean there is alpha. Oh.
Well, it's in the original one, two.
Yeah, so the question is why there is alpha at the end of fill between. So the alpha is a transparency level, and it's solely to make it transparent. So it's you can use alpha equal 1, it will be fully opaque. And, well, it's a bit hard on the eye, so it's only a cosmetic change. So for the scatter plot, you have to use the angle to get the color. So, okay, first task is to remember how you compute the angle. Then you can use this for the color. So it was the question about how do we get color from a number? And this is where we are using the color map. So first, there is a default color map in matplotlib. It's specified in the default, and of course, you can change it. You will see at the end of this tutorial, you have all the color mat from the previous version of matplotlib, so it's not up to date. I need to update it. And so you have this default color map. What will happen when you use this color map is that the color is a value. The color map, let's say it's normalized between 0 and 1, and we also normalize the value, and for this value, we will pick the corresponding color in the color map. So this is quite usual to display any kind of value, and the color map can be used from the one available from matplotlib, and of course, you can also define your own color map if you want. So in this case, the color map is a jet one, I think. So it's only a matter of computing the angle. And if you follow on the graphic, if you follow the color like this, you will see the color map. So this is value 0, and it goes up to 1, really? Oh, no, maybe this is a transition here. And so to get the angle, you have the arc tangent 2 in NumPy that will give you directly the angle in radian. And you can use this for color. And again, matplotlib will, kind of automatically scale your value to, normalize your value and also the color map, so it will just work as expected. And you can try to change the default. Yeah.
So if you try to change the color from T to a fixed real value, I'm getting your message.
Oh, so fixed real value won't work.
Why?
Because it's not a color. So if you want to, when you specify the color, you have a, you can specify one color the same for every point. So in such a case, for example, if you use a black, it means all the points are black. If you want a gray level, you can use coats and say put .7. It means a gray level of .7. If you want to use a real value and you specify the color map, I think it doesn't is not allowed. So what it depends on what you want. What do you want to try to achieve?
Well, so for example, if you wanted to just arbitrarily select one of the colors by taking, so you're defining T is equal to the arctangent, right? And that's kind of a real value number.
Yeah.
Right? So my thought was, well, if you're just picking somewhere, a number somewhere in range, fix it. It's specify C is equal to that value.
Yeah, so you could do that because you have, so you can also use, so there is this default color map. You can also use a color map object to say, hey, what is the color of this value? Then it will give you back a color, and you can use this color in your scatter plot.
But basically what it is that C argument in scatter is trying to interpret what you mean when you say some sort of value, and since there's so... Since it's such a flexible API, when we get just a single float value, we don't know exactly what that means. However, what you could do is give it a NumPy array of just a 1x1 NumPy array of that thing, of that value. Now it goes, hey, you're giving me a value. And a NumPy array of values, I know what to do with that. And it will actually, it should actually use that value to do what you want it to do. But a single value is going to go, oh, I have a scalar value, I'm just going to...
So it's expecting an array.
If you want to do scalar mappables, it's expecting an array. But you could also specify an RGB array or an RGBA array, which is also nuts and things like that. Docstring for scatter really goes into detail about what is and is not allowed. It's just simply putting in a floating point value or an integer or something like that,
it's clearly
not allowed.
Yeah.
Because it's ambiguous about what you mean.
Yeah. So how would I declare an array? I would say...
Well, you might just be able to get away with... I haven't tried it. You might be able to get away with just having square brackets.
Square brackets around a real value.
Yeah.
Right, I believe that might work. I haven't actually tried it myself. I'll try.
Okay, let's try.
My question, so to add on to that, does the array have to match the size of your data array?
That's what we should double check. It may have to match the size of the data, but it might also automatically expand that, broadcast that out. So that's what I want to see if that happens automatically.
Yes, yeah, so why would you have to do that if you could assign it the value of the arctangent?
You can submit a pull request for a feature request to change that and see if anybody, run that up the flagpole and see if anybody takes that. But right now, we're very, very selective about how we interpret things, and we try to make sure that we kind of feel that argument gets a little overloaded in all the features that it can take. So we're a little bit hesitant about making more modifications to that. Again, it came from MATLAB, and we kind of grown past MATLAB now, so we're kind of like, do we really want to keep doing something like this? Don't. But what you can do is that you can actually have the color map object give it the real value. It will spit out an RGBA tuple. And you can assign that to C, and that will work.
It didn't like the inline declaration array. For some reason, it looks like it.
Do you have mp.array?
No. Do I have to use that? I thought you just said if I just put brackets in line, it might interpret that as
an array. I don't have a computer right in front of me, so but yeah, maybe if you do mp.array.
Yeah, so at least with only single value in an array, it doesn't seem to work. It was expecting RGBA, so...
But you can take the color map object and give it a single value. It will
you can go through...
That's actually probably even fewer characters than doing an NumPy array.
Can you show how to do that?
Yeah, jet and... You need jet object.
What the color is for.
Okay, so normally you're making a scatter plot, say color equals blue, right?
Yeah.
Right.
So now I want to say color equals whatever the angle of my data is. How do I do that?
Oh, you're right. Color equal.
Lord, I tried that.
What?
The idea is that the color argument could take a true RGBA, a true color spec, or it can take an array of values that will then get fed through a color map that will then result in a color under the hood.
Okay.
So to answer your question, for example, you can, so let's say CMAP is my object, color map. You get the jet color map from, so this is PLTCM. And then you can say, okay, color equal CMAP of value dot one. Well, it's normalized value. And then you will get the color corresponding to the real value dot one. And then you can use this color in here, for example.
I see. And why did you use sys.exit there? Oh, sorry. Okay.
Make sense? Yeah, C is a color object that matplotlib can understand. And so to answer your question, for example, so this is a solution. So here, I'm computing the angle. So this is an array of values.
And I got that part.
Yeah. Then here I say, oh, C equal T.
Okay.
So what is matplotlib is say, oh, okay, I've been given an array of scalar value. Obviously, they do not correspond to color. So I will use a default color map to map those values to color. And we can, so for example, in this case, we can also specify CMAP equal CMAP. Okay, this is a map I've been using here. And for example, I can use a hot color map, and we got a different result.
Yeah.
So this is not the jet, this is a hot, and we can see the value goes from 0 to 1. No, yeah, like this, based on the angle. It works?
No.
Oh, what's wrong?
Can you show them?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, random normal. No, you're right, random normal. So what's wrong?
Let me try it again. Let me start over.
Yeah, maybe close your session and because X, Y, C, and T. For everybody else, it's working. You got approximately the same figure. So again, you can change the color map. So here, this is another exercise. So this time we are using bar plot. And well, we have two series and we want to draw them. And so again, the idea is you start from this example and you want to have this. And if I write this one, yes. So you start from this script and we want this. And if you run the script, you will get this. So it seems to be pretty easy to get the other part. Right? Start as you explained. So you copy the line, you plot the text. And when you do that, you realize that, okay, maybe something's wrong because the labels are, maybe they are covering the bar or something. And you realize there is two keywords that are important, which one is HA and the other is VA. So those are shortcuts for vertical alignment and horizontal alignment. When you display text, you give a coordinate somewhere and you have to tell matplotlib, how do I align my text relatively to this point? So first you have the HA, which is horizontal alignment. So if you say center, the point you give will be, the text will be centered around this point. Okay? The point here, the text, if you grow, it will be like this. But you can say also left. So left, it means your text will be aligned like this and will go like this. So if you increase your text, it will go into this direction. Of course, if you say right, it will go the other one. And then you have the vertical alignment. It's the same, but it relates to the size of the text. So let's say your letter is this big. If you say top alignment, your text will go below. So it's writing like this, but the top of the letter is at the level of this point. If you say bottom, it will be above. And you have baseline. Baseline is the main line of the text. So it means like A, B, the lower part of A and B are on the baseline. While for P, only the upper part is at the baseline and the tail of the P is below the baseline. So you can think as the baseline as like the natural line for the text. Okay? So each time you specify text position, you have you don't have to specify because of course they are default for this also, but you can also specify. In this case, for these examples, because the labels will be below the bar, we will use a top alignment. So for the other one, it was bottom alignment. So in this case, it will be the same, but we'll reverse and we'll use top alignment, and then it should work. Okay? So this is something to keep in mind. So if we look at the solution here, you can see I've been using the top. and center in both cases. Oops. So next,
keep track of the time. One more hour left.
What time?
Finish it. Maybe keep my one break at some point.
One break, finish it?
Yeah. Okay. At some point.
Yeah, so maybe we can.
Yeah, finish at 12. Yeah.
So, you say one more break?
Maybe.
Yeah, so we are just thinking, okay, we can have one more break because we are still 1 hour together. Yeah, you're definitely sleepy. maybe use some coffee. So let's have a break, like a 10-minute break.
Just a 5-minute break.
The exercise at the end, if we have time, and I would like at least to finish the last part of the tutorial, which is named Beyond This Tutorial. As I say in the beginning, matplotlib have a really extensive documentation and a lot of resources online, and so you really want to dig into this to become expert in matplotlib. So first, you have the tutorial on the matplotlib site. So for most of them, they have been written by the core member of the matplotlib community. And so, for example, you have the pyplot tutorial, image tutorial, text tutorial. So it's you have a lot of stuff around. So we have been talking about text rendering with LaTeX, text property and layout, and etc. You have artist tutorial, so we didn't speak too much about artist during this tutorial, but it's worth a read. You have the path tutorial, so it's an object present in many object on matplotlib. So most of the time you don't use it directly, but it can be really useful in some part. And maybe one of the most interesting is a transform tutorial, where you will learn about the data coordinate, axis coordinates, windows coordinate, and all kind of transformation to go from one system to the other when you need to convert coordinates. So it's also worth a read. You have also the user guide, the frequently asked question, and also you have a, I don't know if it's behind, you have the stack overflow for frequently asked questions. So you have a lot of questions with the tag matplotlib, and you will get a lot of answer. You have the screenshot. You have also documentation from inside the library. So for example, for any comma, you can even PLOC, and you, okay, mat. So you have from the command line, you have the PyDoc command to get all the documentation, so it's pretty extensive, and inside Python, you can also have access to any documentation. So this is the documentation for the whole library, but of course you can also have a .pyplot .plot. So let's try to do that. Pyplot, and we can And this is quite convenient because when you are trying to, let's say you want to plot something and you forgot about the exact syntax, so you have a quick access. So in this case, this is what we have been manipulating from the start of the tutorial. So mostly the minimal command is a plot y. So you don't even need the x, you just give the y values and then you got your plot. And you have all the different arguments that you can use. So it's...
How did you get I missed the command that you used.
Oh, so when you are in Python, so first you import the library and you have the help command. And so if you are using IPython, you have a more convenient way to access this, but this is the basic command. And if you are outside Python, you can use PyDoc, well, it's 3 in my case because this is Python 3, and you will have the exact same documentation. And probably the most important part of the documentation, well, at least for me, and I suspect for a lot of users, is a matplotlib gallery. So if you go after me to the gallery, because it's a lot and a lot of examples, and so the question you have is, oh, how can I do that? And most of the time, maybe you don't know how to express what you want to do, but you have a picture of what you want to achieve. One good way to try to find the solution is to have a look at the gallery. There are many, many examples, and you start and you browse and you try to see which of the examples is the closest to what you have in mind. And when you decided this is the one I want to start from, then you can click on the figure, so you will get a bigger figure to show what's inside, and you have the source of this figure. So it means you can start with this script, you will get this, and then you can start modifying little by little the script until you achieve the graphic you want. And again, if you look at the gallery, I think all the basic cases are covered. So you have all the plot, bar plot, and scatter plot, radar chart, Sankey demo chart. You have polar axis. We don't talk too much about this. Of course, a bar plot, box plot, different layout for all the figure with a color bar. So this is some contour demo. What else? Yeah, if you have the mesh, the ellipse, if you want to draw, well, it's not ellipse, if you want to draw some specific markers, you have all the different arrows. If you remember, I'd say you can draw any kind of arrows in for the annotation. So this is the examples of what you can use for arrows. So you have all kind of different styles. You have all the different boxes around text. So even if you just want to, how I can do this round box, then you got the script. Well, you have the imsho demo, all the color bar, and we didn't, well, it's really a lot of, you have all the 3D demos, so we don't talk too much about this. So again, it's not a full 3D support, but it's a pretty decent, and you can draw a lot of different things. Okay, this is a Axis toolkit. So if you have an even more complex layout, and it can be especially tricky when you want to place a color bar. So we didn't see many examples with that. But from time to time, you want to have, for example, this one here. So you have 4 different plots, and you want to have a single color bar for the 4 of them because you are using the same color map. So this is one way to do it. But if you prefer, you can have four color bars on top of each graphic. So again, you have pretty much every case covered. Okay, so this is really the main resource for starting a new graphic. And there is a smaller gallery that I did some time ago. So this is much smaller. I need to put them into the main gallery. Any question on this? And okay, so let's say you didn't find your answer in the gallery, then you have two mailing lists. So one is for the user and the other for the developer. So maybe you want to subscribe to the user mailing list. And then if you have a problem doing some graphic, you can ask your question. And usually you will get the answer in maybe not in the hour, but at least in the day. And you will have the explanation. The best when you have a specific problem is to have a small script demonstrating either a problem or why you want to achieve, and people will able to help you. You can also browse the archive of this mailing list to have all kind of answer on a specific problem. I talk about Stack Overflow, so there's also a specific tag, and you have, again, a lot of different answer. Last, I put some quick references. So this is all because you have, of course, the documentation. But you can also see on this all the different options you can give for example, for line properties. When you draw a line, you can choose, for example, join style, cap style. So this is for very thick line. It will make a difference. For example, the cap style is how you end your line. So either this is a straight end or this is a round end. So of course, when your line is very thin, you don't really see the difference. But if you have a bigger line, it will make a difference. You have all kind of different option like marker, edge, width. So when you are using scatter plot, you can even change the line thickness of the marker. Okay, so this is called marker, edge, width, and the shortcut is MEW. Most of the parameters for the command use a long name. So this is, in this case, this is a marker edge width, which can be quite long to type. So most of them have a shortcut version. So for example, for line width, the shortcut is LW. Line style, the shortcut is LS. So it's just easier to type. And then you have a marker edge color, MEC, marker face color, MFC. Okay, so again, it's written in the documentation. For the line style, well, you have the regular line style, solid line, dash dot, dotted, and point, and you can also use marker on top of your line. And, so this is when you say the line style equal to, so you either put in quote the minus, or you put V, greater, lesser, S. So this is all the sign. So using this, you can see the correspondence. Then you have all the different markers, and there are a lot of markers. And you can even have your own using, again, LaTeX expression. So if you want to have a marker with a square root of 2, you can. You just say, OK, this is a marker I want to use. And matplotlib will use this as a marker. And so if you're comfortable with LaTeX, you can draw some new marker. You have all the color maps. So unfortunately, this is all color maps. And now there are some better color map. So last year, there was a talk about the new Viridis default color map. So it's a really nice color map. But those are the old ones. So let's say you have the base color map, the gist, sequential, diverging, and qualitative. So when you choose a color map, you're not supposed to choose a color map because it's pretty, but the people do this color map. Yeah, but when you have, for example, a single scalar value, you can use a diverging color map to show the evolution of one value. You can, this is a sequential. This is for like a binomial distribution when you have only two values, negative and positive. So all of those have some signification. And I think this is a link for documenting the matplotlib color maps. You will find all the explanation. So some of them are really well thought. And if you look at the talk for the V-release color map, you will see, so the talk is online, you will see that they choose very carefully the color map, taking all kind of parameters into account, like for colorblind or for colorblind people. If you use a color map on black and white for the luminance, all kind of different conditions. So it's quite good. And in any case, always a jet. Okay, this is a jet color map. You can really forget this. So hopefully it's not the default anymore, but it really hurts your visualization. So I think it was the same in MATLAB, and even in MATLAB it changed this in favor of a new color map that I forgot the name.
Parola.
Yeah, thank you.
Parola. Which so, they advertise as being uniformly perceptually uniform, but it is not.
Yeah, it is not. Yeah. So you have to use matplotlib, it's so much better, and it's free. Yeah, really.
We were also told explicitly by the MathWorks people that we could not actually package Parula in matplotlib either. So we said, okay, we'll just make our own.
Yeah.
And we did, and it turned out it was better.
What?
The new one in matplotlib is called Viridis. It is available in version 1.5, V-I-R-I-D-I-S. Greek or Latin for green, it's available in 1.5, so you can start using it in 1.5, but the default in 1.5 is still Jet. 2.0 will have Viridis as the default.
This is what it looks like, so maybe it's not the best. This one is... Yeah. So you have the new color map on the right, and it's really nice. There is no red, no.
And then also, you heard about that amazing gravity wave, release about 6 months ago or whatever, and the cover of Nature or Science, whatever, they had that beautiful image. Whatever, that was Viridis. They told us they were actually using matplotlib for all their graphics and such, and they used Viridis for that. That's pretty cool.
And the point is that if you use a bad color map like the jet for such a case with your data, you can even miss some information just because of the problem with the jet color map. So it's quite important to use a proper color map, or you will really miss something in your data. I will say a few words about that in a few minutes. And okay, I think that's it for this part. So we can go back to. But do you have any question on this? Too tired? Too hungry? Too bored?
The other awesome thing with color maps is that you can actually create more color maps. These are just the built-in ones. These are the ones that you can just call up by name and it's there. But you can actually create more color maps that are specific, tailored for your needs if you want to. And we're working on some more tools to have it make it easier to take an existing one and modify. The other neat feature is that any of those named color maps, you can put an underscore R on it, and you get the reverse version of that one. But only the named ones, and any of the special ones that you import from other packages and stuff, they don't have them.
only these that are packaged have the ones that you can easily reverse the color map so it goes the other way.
Yeah, we just go through this. So I've been written an article with Michael Drodboom for, it's called 10 Simple Rules for Better Figures. So those are more generic advice for making your figures. So, well, of course, using matplotlib, all the figures have been done with matplotlib. So they are at the start of the tutorial. You have a link to the GitHub repository so you can run the thing. And well, so the first rule is know your audience, meaning that you have to know what are you making the figure for. So it depends if you are, this is for your students, for your colleague, for the media, or whatever. So this is an example of, it was in the New York Times for a study on the cancer. And well, I tried to redo the graphic. So in this case, this is done with matplotlib. And this is a good exercise for you. For example, you see a very nice graphic and you can ask, oh, can I do it? Let's say using your software, but in matplotlib, and how would I do it? So how would you do this using matplotlib from what we've talked so far? What is the main object used in this? Bar plot, yeah. So mostly this is a bar plot, but we tweak it a lot. So actually there is a graphic, one on the left, one on the right. We remove all the spines around, and we keep only two spines. And then for the labels, we compute the middle of the graphic, and we put all the different labels, and then you can add some text. Okay, I can see my pointer. You can see the text. So again, it depends what is the audience you want to address. So in this case, it was a general public. So it's nice to have this kind of graphic. Second rule was identify your message. So in again, this is done with matplotlib. So well, this is for my research in neuroscience. This is a deformation on the superior colliculus, which is a structure of the brain, and the point was to show the deformation from the retina to this structure, and so we use a checkerboard just to see the deformation. So it highlights the fovea, it's a central part of the eye. Rule three is to adapt the figure. So far, you can make a figure for, of course, on an article. And so you will put all the details on all what you want to show to the reader. And because the reader, when he will read the article, he will have plenty of time to look at your figure. So he will see all the small details. But if you are, in a conference, if you use a graphic on the left, it will be first hard to see from a distance, and you won't have time to explain everything. So the best would be to try to make a new graphic, like the one on the right, which only is the main point, and you can add some things to say, oh, I want to... you can refer to the dashed line because you do it in advance. You can say the yellow square and so on. So of course it's more work, but from time to time it's worth the effort. And caption are not optional. You say, yeah, of course, yeah, no. I see, like, okay, on the left, you say, okay, this is optical illusion. Okay, sure. Where is the illusion? And if you don't know it before, you can say, what is optical illusion? Of course, optical illusion is that if you know it, A and B are the same color. You knew this illusion. Okay, so trust me, A and B are really the same color.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
They sure look different.
They look different.
Yeah, I know, they look different. But they are the same color.
But I mean, if A and B were the same color, there would be no checkerboard, right? So you're saying if you remove the green cylinder, it's a flat surface?
It's perspective, it's, or if it's Because the colors around it are different, you perceive it as different. So if you actually were to cut out those, there's actually good examples of this online.
Cut out the green?
Let me...
No, it's because of the shadows.
Yeah. Okay, I will make the demonstration just after, but...
That's pretty counterintuitive.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So, do not trust the defaults. So this is what we have been doing this morning. So you have the default that are good for... that should be good for every figure. So it means they are not the best for a specific figure. So every time you make a figure, you can almost always tweak some settings such that your figure will be better. And again, depending on the default, you can recognize if it's a bokeh, matplotlib, Excel, or whatever. It's a very specific. So well, again, it might cost you some time, but it's worth the effort. And it's an exercise to become better at using matplotlib. Use color effectively. So it means if you don't need color, don't put it. But the most important, it's really the color map that you will be using for your data. So this is an example of the difference between a qualitative color map, diverging, or sequential. And so in this case, we prefer the sequential color map because you see the small details. And if you look at the rainbow color map, it's not that obvious what is happening on the higher frequency domain. So it really make a difference when you will choose your color map and you put it in your article, the reviewer or the reader might not see the same as you see. So you have to try. Do not mislead the reader. So this is, of course, obvious, but maybe it's not that obvious. So for example, when you have if you use a scatter plot to show something, you have to give the size of the circle. So we have been in a matplotlib for the scatter command, we have been using the S parameters, and we have given some size. Question is, is it the radius or the size that we have been given? And perceptually, when you look at this, it's not the same the same perception. So either you use the relative size, so this is on the top, or the radius. And of course, if you compare the quantity, in one case you seem not that different, and in the other case, when you use the radius, they are really they appear really different. In the same similarity, if you have when you use a bar plot, you can. We have seen that we can tweak the y limit. So of course, if you display your data with a full range, you can you get the graphic on top, and you see that all the values seem more or less the same. And if you cut the range, well, you say, oh, this one is really bigger than this one. Okay. So even if you label on your axis that, I'm starting at 60 and I will end at 80, you can inform the reader this is a cut axis. Perceptually, it will be quite different. In the media, you will see this kind of trick like everywhere. If you want to, depending on how you want to introduce data, you can really manipulate the thing. Avoid chart junk. Yeah, you're all smiling, but you can see this in the literature for real. So it's so what's wrong with this?
Let me count the ways.
Yeah, there are many, many things wrong. So first, maybe the label here, too many ticks. So in the end, the text cover each other, and so you cannot read anything. Bad point. The precision of the ticks is not... we don't know why there are so many value after the decimal point, so maybe the result is not obvious. we have a grid for some reason, and it's not even aligned with a signal. We have a background, so it's yellow, okay, it's pretty or not, but why use a background? We have a legend that just covers a signal, which is also quite bad, and we have the color of the plot. Each time you, in matplotlib, each time you draw a plot, matplotlib will iterate over a given number of predefined color, again in the default, and so the first plot will be blue, the second one will be red, the third one will be maybe green, I don't remember all the order, and after maybe 10 plots, it will go back to the first color. So this is why we get all those different colors. Of course, you can avoid this just by saying, oh, I want this plot to be black. So what you can do, so if you are on an article, it's the same area on your sheet of paper, it's just more clear. We just take each signal, we make it stronger, so we manipulate the line thickness, and we put all the other behind with a reduced color and line thickness. And we do that for the 7 series. And okay, so we pretend I pretend this is more clear than the one on the left. But yeah, you can really achieve this kind of graphic. So if you are using Excel with default settings and with this kind of series, I think you can achieve this with not too many effort. You have the background, you have the 3D and stuff. Well, the most important is the message. So of course you can try to tweak, but not too much. And so this is an example for what it's called the uncanny valley. So well known in a robotic field, see how you perceive robots depending on their human likeness. And again, this has been done with a matplotlib with a very nice filter. It's called XKCD filter. So you can just draw anything and you add the XKCD filter and you get this. So just wonderful. Well, it's more or less useless most of the time, but well, at least for this one, we managed to publish one figure with the XKCD style. And the last part is get the right tool. So matplotlib is great for making static figure, making animation, but of course for very specific things, there might be better tools for doing very specific stuff. So I just put a small list of something. One, for example, is called PDF crop. So what it does, it takes a PDF and it just removes all the white border around. And you want to do that because when you put, for example, a PDF in your article, the white border is part of the figure, so you make your figure smaller. So PDF crop, it's very simple. You type PDF crop my file, and it will output the second file. You can also have this for matplotlib. There is a command called tight layout. So at the end, once you are happy with your figure, before saving it, you call tight layout and it will try to remove all the border, the white border around your figure.
So tight layout, there's a bit of a distinction there. There's tight layout and there's V-box inches. So tight layout will help make sure that you don't have anything overlapping each other, which does tend to bring things out into the white border. So if remove white border, it tends to move things out into the white border in order to make any space in between.
Okay, makes a difference.
But then V-box inches equals, quote, tight, in your save big command, that actually will readjust your figure, either grow it or shrink it, so that there is no excess things and that everything is visible. Basically, shrink wraps.
Okay. So you can do it either from, well, at least PDF crop, it's only any kind of PDF, but you can also do it from matplotlib. Another one is graph V. So for example, if you have to plot a graph, like a tree with a link and everything, so well, you could do it with matplotlib, but it doesn't make really sense. Graph V is just to do that, so it's very efficient to draw any kind of a graph. So circle link with arrow to other circle, and the syntax is really really easy. You have image magic. So this is a very powerful tool for manipulating bitmap images. And you have, again, all kind of different script to do all kind of effects. But maybe the most obvious, for example, if you forgot to add some labels on an image, you can do it with Image Magic. It's super easy. The script have been already written. So just after a look, and you will see. GIMP is a GNU image manipulation. So it's for editing your bitmap. Again, if you forgot to add something, I'm not saying about manipulating your output. I'm saying just adding some, labels, or to convert your PNG into a TIFF format. Some journals asking for that. You can also do it with that. Inkscape is the equivalent, but for vector format. So you can manipulate any kind of vector, and the most interesting is you can manipulate PDF. So what do I do for teaching? When I saw a very nice figure that I know is in a vector format in an article, a PDF article, regular research article, you can open the article using Inkscape. It will ask you what pages you want to access. You give the pages, and you will get the figure into Inkscape, and you can rework the figure. So it's really really convenient. It works for any articles. You have also TIX. Do you know TIX? So this is a LaTeX and with a PGF. Okay, I will just show you. So this is also a script language, but you can do all kind of... So you can directly compile it into LaTeX. So when you are writing article into LaTeX, you can add those small code, and you will get all kind of... it's not that easy to write, but you have, again, a lot of different examples. For example, this one. So the advantage is if you are using LaTeX, you don't have to compile anything. It will be done directly with LaTeX. And, you have all kind of different tools. So before, if you need something very specific, maybe there is a tool dedicated just to do that. Any question on this? Any question on the tutorial?
No, it's great. I learned a lot of things today.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
So maybe we can stop here because we have only 10 minutes left. Well, yeah, all the exercise we can try, but no. Okay. Okay, so thank you.
Thank you.